What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of the series, linked in the card above, we highlighted the importance of an approach to software development that is centered on the business domain. And domain-driven design is an approach to developing software that deeply connects the implementation, the code, to the core business concepts, to the domain, to the context of our application. But how can we encapsulate these core concepts? How can we encapsulate the domain inside our code? Well, the best way to do it is to make a software reflection of the domain in which our software is going to incorporate the core concepts and elements of that domain and draw the relationships between them. In other terms, the software must model the domain. And according to Eric Evans, a domain model is not a particular diagram, it is the idea that the diagram is intended to convey. It is not just the knowledge in a domain's expert's head, it is a rigorously organized and selective abstraction of that knowledge. The model is the internal representation of the target domain. For example, if we were developing a banking application, somebody without knowledge of banking should be able to learn a lot just by reading the code in a domain model. When we have a model expressed, we can start doing code design. This is different from software design. You see, software design is like creating the architecture of a house. It's about the big picture. On the other hand, code design is working on the details, like the location of a painting on a certain wall. And domain-driven design combines software design and development practices and shows how design and development can work together to create a better solution. Good software design will accelerate the development, while feedback coming from the development process will enhance the design. Okay, so now we know that it is absolutely necessary to develop a model of the domain, and the best way to do that is by having the software specialists or developers work with the domain experts. However, usually, this approach has some initial difficulties due to a fundamental communication barrier. You see, developers have their minds full of classes, methods, algorithms, patterns, and tend to always make a match between a real-life concept and a programming artifact. They plan what classes to create and what relationships should exist between them. But the domain experts usually know nothing about any of that. They have no idea about software libraries, frameworks, persistence, in many cases even databases. They know about their specific area of expertise. Now, as we mentioned in the previous video, a core principle of domain-driven design is to create a common language between these two parties based on the model. And since the model is the common ground, the place where the software meets the domain, it is appropriate to use it as the building foundation for this language. Then we must request that the team uses this language consistently in all communications and in the code as well. You see, while sharing knowledge and hammering out the model, the team uses speech, writings, and diagrams. But we need to make sure this language appears consistently in all the communication forms used by the team, and for this reason, that language is called the ubiquitous language. This language does not appear overnight. It takes hard work and a lot of focus to make sure that the key elements of the language are brought to light. The ubiquitous language should be fully exercised throughout the modeling process to facilitate communication between developers and domain experts and to discover key domain concepts that should be used in the model. Now, the modeling process will take time, as any domain can be expressed with many models, and any model can be expressed in various ways in code. For each problem, there can be more than one solution. So, how do we choose the best model? And how do we approach the transition from model to code? Well, one model design technique is the so-called analysis model, in which the model is the result of the business domain analysis only, resulting in a model which has no consideration for the software used for implementation. One of the main issues with this approach is that analysts can't foresee some of the defects in their model, leaving very important details to be discovered during the design and implementation process. A model that is truthful to the domain could turn out to have serious problems with object persistence or unacceptable performance behavior. And because of that, developers will be forced to make some decisions on their own and will make design changes to solve a real problem which was not considered when the model was created. A better approach would be to closely relate domain modeling and design. The model should be constructed with an eye open to software and design considerations, meaning developers should be included in the modeling process. The main idea is to choose a model that can be appropriately expressed in software so that the design process is straightforward and based on the model. Tightly relating the code to an underlying model gives the code meaning and makes the model relevant. Getting the developers involved alongside domain experts provides feedback. It makes sure that the model can be implemented in software. If something is wrong, it is identified at an early stage and the problem can be easily corrected. Those who write the code should know the model very well and should feel responsible for its integrity. Developers should realize that a change to the code implies a change to the model, otherwise they will refactor the code to the point where it no longer expresses the original model. Now, tightly tying the implementation to a model usually requires software development tools and languages that support a modeling paradigm, such as object-oriented programming. OOP is suitable for model implementation because they are both based on the same paradigm. Object-oriented programming provides classes of objects and associations of classes, object instances, and messaging between them, making it possible to create direct mappings between model objects with their relationships and their programming counterparts. Creating the model alongside domain experts by using a ubiquitous language will ease the coding process, leading to an overall model-driven design of the code. In the next video of this series, we are going to dive in the main building blocks of model-driven design. And until then, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.